Hey, I'm Jessica from Deep Sea Diver, and this is the JHS Show.
Are you from a musical family?
Yes. My dad, to this day, sings in a barbershop chorus. Sometimes it's a quartet, sometimes it's an octet, whatever. But mostly it's in a chorus, and he does this annual Christmas show that's insane every year. But he's always singing in headphones and harmonizing. And my mom also sings.
All right.
And my dad plays guitar. He gave me my first guitar, 12-string Takamine.
What guitar did you grow up hearing?
You mean on records?
Yeah.
Zeppelin. My parents had a good vinyl collection. Simon and Garfunkel that's how I learned how to, picking patterns and things like that. Of course, the Beatles, they had that. The Carpenters, I don't know, all kinds of stuff. But that was what I heard in my house and then explored outside of that.
Can you remember music fully catching your attention?
Honestly, it was from a really early age. My mom put me in piano when I was five or six. And it was the moment that I started writing music. I remember going to my piano teacher and being like, hey, I wrote these songs, do you want to hear them? And most of her, she said at the time, she was very curriculum based and was like, no, you do that on your own time, and wasn't really interested in that. And that was kind of the moment that my brain split off, where it was like, oh, wait, I think I enjoy this more, writing music than really strict curriculum. Although that taught me how to play music, so. That's when I fell in love, was when I got to hear back things that I would just make up.
Do you remember the first song you ever wrote?
Yeah, it was a waltz, because I was learning I think it was ragtime, actually. I was learning a Scott Joplin song. So I was doing these little chromatic things on the piano and just pretending to be Scott Joplin. I learned a very easy version of some kind of ragtime thing. And I showed my mom, and I got to write it out in sheet music, and I felt proud.
What was the first album you ever bought with your money?
Okay, it was probably Brandy, and it was on cassette.
The Boy Is Mine?
Yeah, totally. And I think the first CD I ever bought was Five Iron Frenzy. No, it was No Doubt.
The Tragic Kingdom?
Yeah, the big one.
Favorite song?
Oh, Spiderwebs, probably.
Tragic Kingdom. I remember getting that, and I was a little afraid to let my friends know I liked it.
Really?
But it was so good.
It was so good. That's how I learned how to, I feel to kind of step into being a performer, too, because of all those music videos. I had, big mirrors in my bedroom when I was a kid, and I would jump off my bed with a guitar and, pretend to be Gwen Stefani, and I don't know. It was fun at the time, just being a little kid, being a little dork.
Do you have a favorite band ever?
If I had to pick, I hate that it's so.
Or do five.
Okay.
Is five easier?
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah. I would say Radiohead, Air. I love Air.
Virgin Suicides?
The Virgin Suicides record is such a good soundtrack. Brian Eno, I've learned so much from him. I mean, there's favorites for different reasons for why I started playing guitar. I mostly have favorite records, not favorite bands, I think that's what it is. One of my favorite records is Beck Sea Change. I can put that on any time of the day. I will say this, my favorite all-time artist or band is Nick Cave and the Bad Seeds.
Okay.
So I've learned the most from him and respect him very, very much. Yeah.
Of formative records,
mm-hmm.
What most plays into your guitar style?
In junior high, so I started playing guitar when I was 11. Between my cousin and a few older friends, I got a Cure record, The Smiths, Meat Is Murder, and the Scream soundtrack that had, or Romeo and Juliet and the Scream soundtrack. So that's how I got into Nick Cave, which is so funny. And then the Romeo and Juliet soundtrack had Radiohead on it.
Those are wildly different. The Scream, I think, has a Creed song on it.
Oh, I'm sure it does. So I would sit in my bedroom and learn all of those records. And so there's a lot of jangly Britpop involved in my early days, and also some kind of shoegazy stuff. And I don't know, I was kind of rebelling against, I think at the time in junior high, Jewel was the biggest artist, and people would always ask me, play Jewel songs. So I'd bring my guitar to school. No.
Yeah.
But I know this guitar.
So because of that era, and you mentioned Brit rock, so Radiohead, obviously.
Mm-hmm, yeah.
But what about other, Oasis, Travis?
I liked Oasis at the time. Echo and the Bunnymen. I listened to, The Clash. I love that kind of sharp, chimey guitar playing on Telecasters and Jazz Masters and Jaguars and all that.
Is there a chord that sounds most like Deep Sea Diver? Is there one thing you can do on guitar?
I feel like I did it in one of our jams where, like, variations of that.
Mm-hmm. It's like C shape.
Yeah, I do.
Yeah. I was like F. Bit of material now, new record coming and stuff.
Yeah.
What's your writing process? How's it evolved? Like, what's it like?
Yeah, well, I think it's gotten better. Typically, it's a, like, on my end, a lot of just being curious, like a lot of journaling. And like, I love, like, I think it was Brian Eno said, just like, don't ever let the pen get dry. And so when I am actually writing every day, songs come a lot easier in terms of lyrics and parts and things like that. And I feel like the best flow that I have is bringing at least some structure of an idea to the band. I have an, like, more of the arranger mindset, production and arrangement and composing and orchestral mindset of the band, and then bringing that and then letting the band be free with the song. But yeah, typically, I don't know, it's not like lyrics always come first, or they come, sometimes I don't know what the song is even about until after the record's out.
So you like having something and yes, then creating it while you're recording?
Yeah, I love being in the studio. It's like, it feels like a really safe place for me, and at the same time, a scary place. And then this last record, I, like, for the first time, co-produced, like, really stepped into that role, and with my friend Andy Park. And so, yeah, there was a really cool relationship that I feel like he was able to push me much farther. I knew my limitations of, like, in the studio, I can go forever and never know when something's good, and I needed definitely a co-producer to, like, put down the foot when stuff is bad or good.
So talk about your background with playing for other artists, getting started.
So I played in, like, just garage rock punk bands, like, in high school, and then I was a solo artist like in my early 20s, and then kind of by chance I started playing with Beck. I knew the music director, and they were looking for, or he was looking for, a new band for the Modern Guilt tour cycle or whatever. And I actually tried out, like, completely thinking I wouldn't get it because I was up against all these session musicians who are excellent, and like, and I was confident that I could play guitar well, but I don't have those kind of, like, studio, like, chops. But I don't think that was Beck was looking for, I guess, because, I mean, he hired me, so that was, like, my first foray into, like, playing with other bands, and that was a crazy, I mean, I literally, like, learned how to play guitar playing Beck songs when I was in elementary and junior high, like, so yeah. It was, like, quite a trip to do that and to be, like, his guitar player, like, blew my mind, learned, like, sitting with, you know, Sea Change and learning Smokey's guitar parts and, like, just crazy. So that was really fun, and I got to tour the world for the first time. And then, like, filled in a little bit in the Yeah Yeah Yeahs playing bass for a buddy, and then joined the Shins for a couple years, yeah.
That's quite an education.
Yeah, it's crazy. I feel like so much of my pedal education came from, like, having to, you know, you're just wanting to enter into those records and into that world, and, like, Beck had so many crazy guitars and pedals too that.
What was the process like coming in as someone to play a tour, albums recorded?
Yeah.
What was that like for you? Like, what pedals did you have at that point? What was that like?
I was pretty bare bones. Like, I think at the time, like, live, I was only using, like, an Overdrive, a Boost, and like maybe a fuzz and one delay. And then like a Elector-Harmonix, like holy grail. Like that was it. Once I started playing with Beck, I like really was listening for like the right, that I picked up like a Fox fuzz, mm-hmm. that octave. I know we talked about that one. It's one of my favorite pedals too. I don't have it on my board because it's too big, but like I started hearing more nuances in tones, and like he had some amazing blackface 60s, 70s amps or whatever. And he let me play his 60s Jazzmaster. That was where really I fell in love with Jazzmasters. And then the shins, like James really just kind of let me do what I wanted to do, and he trusted me with like recreating the sounds, and got into choruses and different delays, and yeah, it was awesome.
So you're doing this, mm-hmm. and then somewhere Deep Sea Divers starts.
Yeah.
So tell us about that.
Yeah, so I, as a solo artist under my own name, like in my early 20s, I was kind of ready to move away from that season of time, and so I started going under the name Deep Sea Diver. I think in 2009-10 I like released an EP called the New Caves EP, and then shortly after I met Peter, who I'm married to and then plays the drums, and we made History Speaks, which was made in 2011 and came out in 2012, like pretty much at the same time the Shins record came out. So we actually ended up touring with the Shins, which was really sweet, but I was very divided though, like I wasn't able to tour nearly enough on it because I was in the Shins.
You'll never have the like I don't have a drummer problem.
That's true.
It's like a problem.
Yeah, knock on wood, yeah.
What was your absolute first pedal ever?
Morley Wah pedal. And I saved up like all of my allowance. It was $50 and it was at this like funny little store down the street. And I think it was $60, but he felt so bad for me because I'd come back to the store every time. And I was like, I have $40. He was like, I'm sorry. And then I finally got 10 more from mowing someone's lawn.
It's a like, black
you
one.
May have it.
The big
black with
one?
The red writing of Morley
on
it.
Yeah, the biggest.
It was probably because I was wanting to play Rage against the Machine stuff.
Ask.
Yeah, totally. Yeah. And that and like Jimi Hendrix.
Like Bulls on Parade.
Totally. Yeah. Okay. I didn't know how I got the I didn't know what a whammy was at the time, and so I didn't understand how I got the other sounds.
Let's talk about your favorite pedals ever.
Okay.
Some of which you probably have on your board.
Yeah.
So just go for it.
Okay.
Talk about like your house is burning and you grab these pedals.
Yeah, no, totally. Yeah. Okay, so if my house was burning, I would grab my Memory Man. I used to have the older version, but I think it got lost in Shin's days. But
they break all the time, too.
Yeah, no, totally.
Yeah, that one's great.
Yeah, no, they're awesome. I would grab my Pleasure Trem 5000 because I have never heard another tremolo pedal like that. I like controlling it with my foot down here, but it has such a nice like cut off with the depth rolled all the way up, and it's you can do like triangle or square wave, so you can get that's some very extreme tremolo. But I like a lot of the effects that I had on Secrets. We're on that.
Is your verb after the trim?
It's before it.
Yeah.
The tremolo is the very end, so it's cutting. It's cutting everything.
Oh, it's
so you can get such like. Yeah. Your phone is talking to us. Maybe it found me another Pleasure Trem 5000.
It says I found this on the web for is there verb after the trim? All right.
Everybody, throw your iPhones away.
What about these drives?
Yeah, Earth Drive. Nels Klein turned me on to this one. And it's like a really, I hate like gear words, but more of like a transparent drive and chimey. So it lets the guitar come through more. Whereas like the Brothers, which I also love, is a little fuzzier and cooler. And then it has a fuzz on it too that I like using. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's really versatile.
I love your use of fuzz.
Thank you. I have your pedal on there.
Yeah. And I think it's like really familiar because I play the Jazz Master and there's the fuzz and it's like, yeah,
yeah,
that's cool.
I'm a big fan of gated fuzzes, splatty fuzzes, real like, I don't do too many fuzzes that are more like in the Smashing Pumpkins vein, which I do love.
Yeah, yeah.
But that like really, I feel like
brutal.
Death by Audio does a lot of that cool
yeah,
stuff.
Yeah.
Like,
I heard you do this weird thing where you have, I think your delay is routed after
before the overdrive.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, I do this thing where I turn like my diamond delay mix all the way up. And then, so it has this weird reverse effect. I was trying to recreate a part on Impossible Way that we did in the studio where it was actually reversed.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, you can kind of fake it when you put it. I think I have compression on too, so it's just kind of carrying that like.
That's a perfect example. Like people are always asking what order to put my pedals in.
Yeah.
And it's like,
yeah.
Yeah.
No, totally. There's no right answer.
Yeah, technically delay after, but that's like the coolest sound.
Yeah. The only way I can do that with this board is like because I have this looper switcher and it allows you to put pedals whichever way you want.
So my favorite guitar that I have, I play it all the time. It's a Built.
Yep.
It's the one with all the crazy freaking pickups. But this guy, talk about it.
Yeah, so I was so excited. They contacted me a few months back and I had never designed a guitar from the ground up. And I mean, this is like already an existing model, the SS Saftic, but I've never gotten to choose color, pickups, bridge, all those things. And so I wanted to marry I have an Elvis Costello Jazzmaster and a Starcaster. And I wanted something that was light to kind of maybe replace the Starcaster a lot because that thing's like 10 pounds and it's just heavy. And this thing is like so light and amazing. And so I put El Rayo humbuckers in it, which are actually pretty similar to single coil Jazzmaster soapbox pickups. And they have this chime to them that a lot, like in clarity and bell-like tone that a lot of humbuckers don't have. I have wide range humbuckers on my Starcaster, but like, so let me turn this off. But it has a Jazzmaster-like quality to it, but once you start kind of pressing in on the overdrives, it has more humbucker feel to it. Yeah.
Guitar has been kind of like this like bro thing forever.
Oh yeah.
It feels like it's just guy. It's like you go to NAMM or you go somewhere and it's just dudes.
Yes.
And lately, so like last year, 2019 and 18, there's been like some really cool surveys done and more girls, women are buying guitars than guys.
I love that.
How do you, like, are you excited about this? Like
we're seeing
this flood of like, we're unbroing guitar.
Yes.
It's exciting.
Yes, I am like such an advocate for that, of course, being a woman and like just, I give lessons to a lot of kids and a lot of them are like younger girls who just like want to play in bands and just, I want to be as empowering as possible to, I mean, any kid that wants to pick up a guitar or instrument, but like I'm all about just like demystifying the studio process and like, because that can be really intimidating to like get into engineering as a female and I just love geeking out with like younger kids about just, don't be afraid to just like step in and be bold, and especially for females.
Yeah, what's some advice you have for young players? You have a really crazy story, long road. Like, what's your advice for jumping in and doing it?
Probably the biggest pieces of advice I can give is to not wait on anything. Like, don't wait for, a lot of people are just like, how do I get a manager? How do I get a booking agent, a label? Just like, don't think that way. Like, just make the music. And often, like 9 out of 10 times, the way someone discovers your music is not the way that you planned. And so just to be like, to hold music really loosely in a way, because it is such a malleable, subjective thing anyways. And so like, do it because you love it, and you know, have high expectations and goals and all those things, but like also hold them loosely and see where it takes you.
You have finished a record.
Yes.
I think it's out right now.
Yeah.
I think right now, because we're in the past.
Yeah.
I don't know. But yeah, what was this like? I've heard it.
Yeah.
It's really good.
Thank you. So Impossible Weight, that's the name of the record. And the record, in the most beautiful and harrowing way, was an impossible weight to get through. I think this band, I kind of fell apart like 2 years ago, where I wasn't sure I was gonna keep making music in this form and under Deep Sea Diver. And like, we kind of just had a lot of reconciling moments for myself and in the band, and music started coming again in a really lovely, natural way. And there were things that I meant with my whole heart rather than forcing them, which I felt like I was forcing it for a long time. Peter, he was the one that said, I think you should produce this record. And I like honestly like shrunk into a shell when he said that, because I did not trust my instincts at the time. I was like, okay, I'll do it if I find a really awesome co-producer too, because I know my weaknesses, and like I will spend forever in the studio and never finish something. And also like I wanted, whereas what like Secrets was kind of a darker, more brooding, experimental record, in a lot of guitar, like heavy guitars, and in the rhythm section it was like really not complex, but like a quilt, like a lot of patterns woven together. This record, I knew that I wanted it to be not any less arty or weird, but like I wanted to sharpen the songwriting on it. Like I've been, you know, I've just done bedroom recording for so long, but like I geek out about engineering, and it was so fun to go in with such a strong vision of what I wanted, and to like, I don't know, just feel proud of like, okay, these songs, they feel like not stronger than Secrets, but they feel greener. So Secrets was red, I called the red record. Like these songs, I felt like they were, the color was green. They felt more alive, and like you could take more breaths in them. And yeah, and they were written from a much more vulnerable place.
It's cool. It's a great record.
Thanks.
All right, rapid fire.
Okay.
Sushi or a burger?
Sushi.
Dogs or cats?
Dogs. Dude, I have a beagle.
Okay, no cats.
I love cats. I love all animals, except for reptiles.
What's your favorite color?
Green.
Okay. Backstreet Boys or NSYNC?
Backstreet.
Paul McCartney or John Lennon?
Oh my God, that's hard. Why are you doing this to me?
Can't think about it.
Okay, Lennon.
Really? Walmart or Target?
Target. Target, Target.
Seinfeld or Friends?
Seinfeld.
Okay, awesome.
Friends. Thank you, yes.
I don't like
Larry
Friends
David
either.
For life, man.
I don't like Friends. Favorite salad dressing?
I love a great honey vinaigrette.
Really?
Yeah, totally. Honey mustard vinaigrette.
I try to predict people's salad dressings.
Do you think I was a ranch girl?
I don't know. Blue cheese, maybe. Best concert you've ever seen?
I would say probably Radiohead. It was like one of the first Coachellas, when it, like, there was only probably 30,000 people there, which now it's like a million. I don't even know. I don't go anymore.
Who are your 5 favorite guitarists?
Robert Fripp, Jeff Tweedy, Nels Klein, Blixa from The Bad Seeds, and Johnny Marr.
You were with Wilco.
Mm-hmm.
I saw some clips of you playing.
Oh, yeah.
What was that like? Was that fun?
That was so fun. I mean, and Nels and I got to solo together and do some guitar minis on the fly. It was just amazing. For record time, I picked Another Green World by Brian Eno. Eno had some really heavy hitters come in on this record, and two of those people were Phil Collins. I think he played drums, I'm pretty sure. And then Robert Fripp, who's one of my favorite guitar players. And the song Golden Hours has this guitar solo that I think I've been trying to learn how to play my entire life, but like it sounds like a snake is playing guitar. It's crazy. It's very Slytherin. It's the most notey guitar solo, but there's no effects on it, and it's amazing. It's just from another world, and I think that's what he was going for.
Since you're here, yeah. Let's play one of your new songs.
I'd love to. My band is right over there.
That's who those guys are?
I think so.
Thanks so much for watching this. Stop everything you're doing and go download, buy, go to the record store, whatever you need to do, and grab Impossible Weight. It is out today by Deep Sea Diver. This is a big moment. It's like an album release episode. Like, it feels right. We gotta do this more. Anyway, do that now. Also, in the description below, there is a link where you can enter to win this. I found it in my record stash. It is an unopened copy of Secrets, her last record. It's one of my favorite records ever. Her guitar playing is amazing. It's been on Record Time before. Click the link in the description. You can win this. We'll mail it right to you free of charge. Also, like this episode if you liked it. Subscribe and click the bell icon to get notifications of future episodes. There is the Patreon account where you can go learn more about history, be a part of the show. There's also the JHSShow.com where you can go buy useless t-shirts like I'm wearing and just waste your time. You might want to do that. That's it. This has been really fun. Huge thank you to Jess and Ben for coming by and hanging out.
I'm going to go listen to this album on repeat for about 5-6 weeks, maybe 7 weeks. I'm out. Bye.